Hallo Ron, today we are here at the Militärhistorische Museum Dresden with Jens Wehner.
Hello.
And we will talk why the T-72 was perfect for the Third World War.
Yeah, we will do. And we are sitting here on a T-72 from the National People's Army. In German, it means Nationale Volksarmee. So this was the army of the Eastern German state, GDR. And they had roughly 70 T-72 acquired from the Soviet Union. And this was the most modern tank of the National People's Army. And if you ask why this tank was perfect for World War III, then one answer is perfectly if you look at the National People's Army. Because this was the most modern tank of the National People's Army, meaning they could afford it. Yeah. They left out the T-62. Why? Because they said it had not much improvement for the price we have to pay for this tank. So there was a gap, like in some other Warsaw Pact armies. But the T-72 was a huge step forward, and it was in some way affordable, even for the quite weak economies of the Soviet satellite states. And this is also the reason why you find T-72 all over the world, like Iraq or other states all over the world. And so the T-72 is quite a good mix of firepower, mobility, protection, the holy trias, as you would say. And on the other side, in a cost, in the price you have to pay for this tank. And it had some very modern features for its time when it was introduced in the Soviet Army in the 1970s. It had a smoothbore cannon, yeah, with high velocity AP ammunition, which was not very common in the NATO at this time in the 1970s. It's more an 80s style in the NATO. It has already a quite modern armor with different materials made of the armor, and it had also a quite good mobility. It had a huge engine and was quite fast.
So what other features has the T-72 that makes it perfect for the First World War?
Yeah, it has already a composite armor with different materials, which is quite good for anti-heat capability, and it's also quite good against ABC, as we say in German. I think in English you say NBC.
Yeah, NBC, nuclear, biological, chemical.
Yeah, it has already whole protections against this, which is quite important for World War III, of course, because there should be no illusions. Most experts and historians think that if it comes to World War II, or if World War III had been happen, there would be an atomic war. Of course, on the battlefield with...
So at least on the tactical level, nuclear weapons.
At least, yeah, at least. But let's say, but you have to calculate with tens of thousands of atomic bombs during World War III. So the survivability in atomic war is quite important for World War III. But even if you say it's a conventional war, one has to say the losses because of conventional weapons, like, let's say, ATGM, so anti-tank guided missiles, would be very high. And so the price and the cost of a weapon system is also very important, because you have to replace it. You would have higher loss rates. And I know a man who visited a Soviet tank factory after the fall of the Soviet Union, as he was in the tank factory, let's say it so, sorry, as he was in the tank factory. The people there told him, we are able to build 800 tanks, T-72, out of the blue, just with no preparation, with no further materials or so, just 800 T-72 a week, which means over 3,000 T-72 in a month. And let's say it's not the only factory in the Soviet Union able to produce tanks. So you see, it's very important that you are able to product tanks and place them on the battlefield.
So it was also, in that case, probably the Soviets also have proper training facilities and everything to man these tanks.
I don't know. We don't know how the Soviet planned this. I think it's still secret in some ways.
Yeah.
I'm not so sure about the training capability after high losses. Who knows?
Yeah, but again, I think tank troops have rather limit or usually have a higher survivability than infantry. At least in World War II, it was always the case.
Yeah.
But
you know, when I was in the army as a tank driver, we were told everybody is shooting at you at first.
Yeah.
And you have a lot of armor-breaking weapons on the battlefield.
Actually, you were a Leopard
driver? Leopard 1.
Driver. So in terms of World War II to World War III, so did the survivability for tank crews go down after the Second World War in terms of you get a hit? Or did it go over, stayed it the same? Because we know in the Second World War, the Panzer divisions and also all the others usually ran out of their Panzer Grenadiers or their mechanized infantry. So, but I could suspect, but I could be terribly wrong, that these tanks actually, when they get hit nowadays, that the likelihood that you have a total loss of the crew is higher or lower, I don't know. Because I think the Abrahams, I think, has something to blow out the ammunition and certain preparations.
Yeah,
so was there a change or is it more or less the same?
I think it's a little bit like in World War II, actually. So if you have a T-34 in World War II, there is a high probability that this tank would ziehen seinen Hut, as we say in German, meaning that the tower, the turret is blown off by an explosion. And I think this is the same as the case with the Soviet tanks in the
Cold War. Lollipops.
Yeah, because they are very cramped. They are very small, as you can see. They have a low silhouette. And this means...
either you hit ammunition or you hit fuel.
Yeah, something like this. Or even if not, the whole power that is set free by a penetration makes vibrations and little chaos into the turret or into the combat room. And this can be enough to make some fires and explosions and so on, even if you're not hit, especially the ammunition or the fuel tank or something like this. And the Western tanks are not so cramped. They are bigger. They have more rooms. They have more safety. And as far as we can say, I think from the battlefields in, let's say in Yom Kippur war or in Iraq war or in the real wars during the Cold War, I would say it's a little bit the same like in World War II.
But so higher survivability in Western.
Yeah, higher survivability. Especially if you look at the Israeli Merkava, especially built to save the people. Yeah, there you can see this is the most Western tank if you want so.
Yeah. Okay, but back to the T-72. Sorry, we got a bit off track. I mean, after all, we're on a tank. So, is there anything else to add about why it was perfect for the Third World War?
Yeah, I think it's not so much that it has some special capabilities, that it has the highest penetration, the best mobility, the best armor. That's not the case, but it has a nice mix. Let's say it so. And it's very affordable and in high numbers. And that I think this would be decisive, as it was a little bit, has to say, in World War II.
So, also not high tech and everything. So basically maintainability, affordability, and then the Holy Trinity. Mm-hmm. So it has the combinations basically on the, it has the tactical capability. Mm-hmm. And it has the strategic for capabilities in terms of production and resources.
Yeah, but one has to say in the 1970s, when this tank was new, it was quite advanced. Yeah, if you look at the NATO tanks at this time, for Germany, let's say Leopard 1, which is very light armored, or if you look at the American tanks like the M60, this tank is quite more advanced one. Yeah, but in the 80s it turned against the T-72, but still it was quite affordable, even for the satellite states of the Soviet Union.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching and see you next time. Bye.